Okay, ladies and gentlemen, I'm sorry we're starting 1 minute late. I will speak faster to compensate for the time we lost. Tonight's talk is really fascinating, I think. A very unusual figure named Rabbi Levi ben Gershon, known by the Latin term Gersonides, or son of Gershon, as we've seen with Maimonides, Nachmanides, and so on. It's a fascinating figure who really, in many ways, encapsulates the nexus of Jewish and scholarly non-Jewish work in his century, in the High Middle Ages, and the kind of research that he produced, both in the secular realm and in the Jewish realm, are really amazing when you understand the context of 12th and 13th century France in particular. So my goals for tonight are to give you just a sense of the backdrop. We're going to concentrate on the ecclesiastical history and on the economic history of the Jews at that time, just to give you a sense of the kind of environment in which he operated. And then I'm going to highlight a few of the areas in which he was active as a scholar, and I'm going to basically leave aside all of his Jewish research, which is really quite fascinating and controversial, and I will leave that to my very capable colleague and friend, Rabbi Trump. So that is the plan for tonight. Okay, let's get started straight away then. So here's a great picture of him. This is obviously an Israeli stamp from 2009 to commemorate Gersonides' contributions to astronomy. And he is associated with the development of this interesting navigational instrument called the Jacob's Staff. I did a little bit of reading on Wikipedia to figure out what exactly is a Jacob's Staff, and I'll explain it to you when we get a little further into this talk. But basically, it's a really fascinating navigational instrument to measure distances using solar bodies and a few other kind of cool things. But his years, 1288 to 1344, that's like the High Middle Ages. It's the point of time in history when the church is at its peak. And I want to just really emphasize that because so much of our topic is going to revolve around that. One of the great struggles in the High Middle Ages is the conflict between the church and the state, between the churches, the popes, and the kings. It's a tremendous amount of conflict. The churches generally try to stick with dogma and ideology, and that is generally not so good for the Jews, although in some interesting circumstances they actually would come to the defense of the Jews when dogma was favorable in that way. Whereas the temporal powers generally saw the economic utility of the Jews and tried to enact legislation that was appropriate to draw more Jews and encourage their settlement in European regions. We shall see that there are a lot of tensions involved in that between church and state, and the Jews eked out a very difficult existence quite often in the 13th century in particular as a result of this conflict. Let's scope ahead. Okay, so first of all, here is just a quick overview of some elements of church history. The high point of the church's power in the 13th century is without a doubt the work of this man, Innocent III. It's a very ironic kind of title for a pope because he is widely recognized as one of the most anti-Semitic popes of history. He was quite obsessed with the Jews, and he enacted a lot of legislation, of papal legislation, that was adhered to through much of Europe that restricted Jewish activity on a social and an economic and on a demographic level as well. Perhaps the most notorious of his innovations was a series of codes enacted at the Fourth Lateran Council early in the 13th century that, among other things, required Jews to wear distinctive dress. One of the most common expressions of that distinctive dress is this conical hat shown here that is known as the Judenhut, or the Jew's hat. It was not a complimentary look. It tended to accentuate the features, and it was kind of like a silly sort of hat that was designed to make the Jews look ridiculous and also to stand out from others, because Innocent III was very concerned about the the social fabric of that would allow Jews and non-Jews to mix readily, and so the Judenhut was designed to be a specific marker that would help Christians avoid commerce with Jews, both intellectually, economically, and socially. He also, later on, the Fourth Lateran Council developed other forms of distinctive Jewish dress. The Jewish badge was developed at this time. It was not, contrary to popular opinion, the yellow Star of David. That developed much, much later. It was typically a coin, a round badge, sometimes worn on the back shoulder blade and sometimes on the shoulder, that was usually yellow in color, and it was a reference to the coins that Judas received for betraying Jesus. That was supposed to be the metaphor there. Also sometimes shown are tablets, like the round top tablets, the Shnei Luchos HaBris of the Ten Commandments were sometimes used as a badge. But the Judenhut is perhaps the most popular. And it's actually a boon for art historians, because that means whenever we look at these kind of medieval images, we can always pick out who is a Jew. Here you have a Jew conversing with some ecclesiastical figures. Here's another picture that shows the Judenhut in a form that you may see more familiar today. What kind of hat does that look like? Yeah. Oh, it looks like a Klan hat. That is a strange irony of history. That's not the answer I'm looking for, but it does look like a dunce cap, right? That's what we call it in Canada, dunce cap, because it was like, that's like the hat of shame, right? It's like the opposite of what you put around dogs' necks. Just turn around, put it on the head kind of thing. And like the witch's hat, right? Because Jews in the 14th century in particular were very much associated with the devil and with witches. And so we have kind of secularized it and kind of made it fun with witches and the Halloween and Broadway shows and things like that. But in reality, it comes from the Fourth Lateran Council, and it shows its expression into first in Jews and then to other nasty people that we don't like. Here is one of the other developments in this period of time. The 13th century was the evolution of disputations. And you'll recall we discussed in the very first class the great disputation that the Ramban was involved in 1263. These were a regular feature of the 13th and 14th century. Even going into the Tortosa disputation in the 15th century was an ongoing occurrence where Jews were forced to participate in these debates, which were show trials of Judaism. Judaism always was meant to lose in these debates. The dispute that Ramban participated in 1263 was quite unusual in that he really won the debate and humiliated the opposing side, but in reality it was usually something that Jews simply could not win. They had to endure it, and the consequences of these debates were typically forcible attendance at churches to listen to sermons, sometimes ritual humiliations like a yearly slap on the face to the head of the Jewish community on the eve of the holiday of Easter, things like that. In this shot, of course, you can see this woodcut. You can see ecclesiastical figures here and Jews wearing the Judenhut. Again, easy to identify them. The ecclesiastical figures here are using hand gestures, which in medieval art are very aggressive and polemical. Pointing like this is considered to be a very strong gesture of instruction, of didactic instruction. And the Jews, meanwhile, are not making eye contact, and they're kind of like looking to their books, trying to figure out how to respond to the critiques and so on. So that was a feature of the 13th century. There's one guy pointing over here. Yeah, I thought you'd point that out, Boaz. That's a hard question. I'm not sure why. Okay, and finally you have the ongoing attack on the Talmud in the 13th century, which is really quite nasty. We haven't explored it too much in these classes, but in the early 13th century, the church, as it were, discovers the Talmud. A convert to Christianity named Nicholas Donin explains to Pope Innocent III, hey, you know why the Jews aren't converting to Christianity? The whole thing is because they have this secret book that the church can't read because it's written in Aramaic. It's not written in Greek or Latin or even Hebrew. And if you read that book, you'll see there's so much indoctrination there, convincing the Jews to remain Jewish, to deny Christianity. It says all kinds of libelous and slanderous things about the founder of the church and so on. And so Innocent III gives him the nod, and there's a lot of investigations. The disputations go along with it, and ultimately the Talmud is burned. And these are precious manuscripts. These are not, you know, bound volumes that are mass-produced. We're talking about handwritten manuscripts of incredible value. According to the records of the early 13th century in 1242, some 42, or maybe it was 24, I may be reversing the numbers, wagon loads of Talmudic manuscripts were all burned in Paris. An incredible array of documents that lost forever. So that was the first major one, yes. So these are kind of like the anti-Semitic church-inspired anti-Jewish legislation that occurs in the 13th century. Definitely very inhospitable environment from that perspective. Okay, let's move. So that's kind of like the ecclesiastical legislative environment. Let's look at the economic history of the time as well. Very important thing that actually reverberates throughout Jewish history is this piece of church legislation called the Decretium Gratiani, or the Law of Gratian, who was a major church thinker in the 12th century, shown here, who codified a law that had incredible economic implications for Jews. Basically, he read the Book of Devarim the same way that Jews read it when there is a prohibition on interest. It has that phrase that says you're not allowed to charge interest to your brother. To the stranger, you may charge interest, but not to your brother. So Jews read that as the pro, and Muslims too, incidentally, read that as a prohibition of interest between co-religionists, that Jews may not charge interest one to each other. So he said, fine, but they may charge interest to Christians because they are not your brother. They're from another tribe, as it were. So Gratian said, fine, that makes sense for Christians too. Christians may now not charge interest on any loans to other Christians, but they may loan money to non-Christians and charge interest, and more significantly, they may borrow money from non-Christians and pay interest. Now, you got to realize, of course, that the only minority of any size in Christian Europe are the Jews. Everyone else is Christian. There are various varieties of Christians, and as you move further to the east, you have more pagans, really. But in continental Christian Europe, it's basically Christians and Jews, and there's nobody else. So the only people who are going to be able to engage in this kind of commerce are Jews. So while on the one hand, it sounds a little bit discriminatory in the sense that, you know, the Jews were singled out for this one particular economic niche. On the other hand, it was suddenly handing the Jews a monopoly in an incredibly important aspect of the developing economy. Remember that in an agrarian economy that is just emerging from a barter-style economy to a cash-based economy, when you have the ebb and flow of expenses and income, you put all of your assets into the ground during planting season and then you wait for it to be harvested in the harvest season. If you have some kind of you have to make a chasana or something in the middle and you don't have any income coming in, you've got to borrow some money. Or in the case, well, there's many more examples of this, but at any rate, he handed to the Jews in the 12th century a monopoly on any kind of interest-bearing activity, which was huge. Jews took to it with alacrity. Let us recall, by the way, there seems to be a widespread belief that Jews were money lenders because they could not own land. It's simply not true. Jews could own land in many parts of Europe. There were only limited areas where they had any meaningful restrictions. The truth is, Jews did not want to own land. It was much more practical to be in commerce. Commerce is portable. You can do it anywhere. And that's very good because if you're subject to an expulsion, you can take your cash and take it with you. You can't do that if you have, you know, a massive farm and you're expelled from the country. You lose everything. It allows time for Talmudic study because you can maintain banker's hours. And it's very profitable. And we're talking about interest rates that go from 30 to 50% in the medieval period. It's an extremely great way to make a living. It's intellectual work. It's not, you know, physical labor. It appealed to Jews heavily. It also allowed Jews to be urbanized because Jews are a gregarious people. We like to live in close proximity to one another. We have to live within walking distance of a synagogue, of a mikveh, of a Chinese restaurant. All these things have to be like really close by. Now I would have to say a joke with sushi. But, you know, this kind of work was extremely helpful for Jews because it gave them that kind of lifestyle. Let me just, I'm a little bit worried about time. Let me just skip ahead because I want to make sure that Rabbi Trump has a little bit. Here's another another great picture. You can see the Judenhut here, an interesting kind of take on it. But in some of the medieval artwork, you can also see the distorted physiognomy of the Jews here. The pronounced nose actually dates back easily to the 11th century. And here they are counting coins. This is a Jew and a customer. Here's another customer dealing with the Jew, a big bag of money, or perhaps that's a pledge, I'm not sure. And here's one of my other favorites. This is a woodcut dating a little bit later. You can see here that the nobleman is coming to borrow some money. He's got his hand out extended. Anyways, here's the Jew over here. The artist obviously didn't know Hebrew because he kind of put at the hem here the sort of imitation of what he thought Hebrew looked like. The Jew has, he's seated and relaxed. He has a big bag of money here. Anyone recognize what this thing is here?
An abacus.
That's right. When I teach undergraduates, 18 years old, they're totally clueless. Boaz, I bet you had no idea what that was, right?
I knew the name. The name slipped from my mind.
Oh, right. Okay. Very good. Sure. So that's the abacus, and he uses that to calculate, right? It's talking about, you know, it's clean work. It's intellectual work. It allows time for Talmudic study. It's a great way to make a living. However, it provokes a certain degree of animosity because everybody likes to borrow money. Nobody likes to pay money, and absolutely nobody likes to pay interest. This is especially the case when people with power borrow money from the Jews, which happened frequently. Even kings and nobility would enter into these economic relationships with Jews, and what would happen is they would be, the debt ratio would raise a little bit too high, and so it became much more expedient for the rulers to simply expel the Jews. Then, of course, they would realize, wait a second, now we have no credit whatsoever in our society because of the laws of Gratian. We better invite the Jews back. And as you can see, just from this list, and this is France alone, I haven't even bothered with the other countries, when legal historians look at the history of legislation, they see that the same law is passed over and over and over again, it means that people are ignoring the law. If you see so many signs, do not jaywalk, do not cross against the light, you know that people are crossing against the light all the time. And so France alone, you can see between the 12th and the 14th century, there's five expulsions just in France. Because as Jews become wealthy through their money lending and the debt ratio is high, the nobles simply say, get out, that's it. You also have the risk of peasant revolts from below because Jews, especially as you move past the 14th century, when the Italian banking houses find ways around the law of Gratian, then Jewish money lending tends to get much smaller. It's still quite pervasive, but Jews are, you know, selling and buying generally, you know, small implements and small amounts of money to peasants. Then you occasionally have huge peasant revolts, like the Khmelnytsky rebellion in the 17th century, for example, that are also quite devastating and also extremely violent as a result. Here's a map just to give you a flavor of what continental Europe was like vis-a-vis expulsions, and you can see they're happening all over the place. Smaller regional expulsions, temporary expulsions. This map also does not indicate the number of states that imposed restrictions where Jews could stay in place, but they simply could not engage in money lending for 10, 20 years, and then they would say, okay, money lending is good, let's do it again, and then the debt ratio would go high. It was a very tenuous and difficult time for Jews. And this is the period in which we have Gersonides active. The Ralbag is an acronym for his name, Rabbi Levi ben Gershon, but he's also known by the title Magister Leo de Bagnol or Leo Hebraeus. Bagnol is a place, I'm not exactly sure where it is. Anyone know where Bagnol is? I think it's in Spain, maybe, but Italy, maybe Provence, maybe Provence. That sounds reasonable. And Hebraeus means the Jew, obviously. Leo the Jew. The Magister is an interesting title. It indicates a level of learning that is recognized by other masters. This is still a period when university studies as a whole were really quite primitive, and you know, we're just beginning to emerge from the ecclesiastical circles to become secular institutions. He was recognized as a genius by his peers in secular realms of study. In math, he wrote a very important work called Maase Choshev, also known as Sefer HaMispar, the Book of the Number, which was translated into Latin, and that's the way that we have it today. We apparently do not have the Hebrew original, but the Latin translation is De Numericis Harmonicis, on the harmony of numbers. very poetic kind of approach to mathematics. He's also known as a very important conduit of philosophy. And this is a role that many Jews played in the Middle Ages because of their linguistic affinity for the Semitic languages. Aristotle was perhaps one of the most significant philosophers studied in the Middle Ages. The Rambam, of course, relied on him very heavily, referred to him as ha-philosoph. Rabbeinu Yonah said that Aristotle was one level short of Ruach HaKodesh, of divine inspiration, but Aristotle was often a closed book to Christian readers, until we have St. Aquinas in particular who brings him out. But many aspects of his work were not really widely studied at all, even in church circles, and Gersonides was an individual who borrowed them heavily and translated them two languages that people could read in Europe. He also relied heavily on the sort of crib notes versions of Aristotle that come from Ibn Rushd, also known as Averroes, who was a very important Islamic philosopher that translated a lot of Aristotle into Arabic that Gersonides could then access and discuss in Latin and other European languages. Finally, he was also extremely well known as an astronomer. Here we get to this great Jacob's staff thing. He invented this instrument, which looks deceptively simple. I'm not exactly precisely sure how it works, but it's a way, it's got this kind of crossbar here with measurements on this rod, and by eyeballing a fixed point on the ground and a fixed solar object and lining up this crossbar to make sure that you can see both of them at the same time with no gaps in the line of sight, you can then make calculations as to how far apart these things are. And if you are in a moving ship across the ocean or something like that, you can use it to determine how far you have traveled vis-a-vis the relationship. Check this out here. These are cool drawings. The resolution isn't that great on this projector, but you can see here's someone who is actually figuring out with the Jacob's staff the distance between the moon and a star. Here's some people using it to calculate the height of buildings. Really interesting applications of this very simple instrument that Gersonides invented. And by the way, modern surveyors use this technique even today. They're still working with this thing invented by the Ralbag some 700 years ago. This is a more modern version of it. You can see that it's a little bit more refined because it has several levels, but the markings are all on the staff. The same basic instrument that has tremendous usage. Now, what I'm not going to go into today because we have Rabbi Trump to speak in much greater detail about it, but he was also a huge polymath. And again, this is in a period of time where the division between the sciences was not altogether fixed. I mean, a person who was really smart was expected to be smart kind of across the spectrum. We didn't have such high levels of specialization of the sciences and literatures and so on. And so he was an incredible Talmud Chacham, viewed with considerable controversy in many circles. His most famous work, however, was this book, Milchamot Hashem, a title that's used by many authors, The Wars of God, and it deals with a whole range of questions in Jewish theology, borrowing heavily from Aristotle and Averroes in particular, as we discussed. Okay, Rabbi Trump, you're ready? Okay, so thank you very much for your attention. Let's turn it over to the real talent, Rabbi Trump.
Okay, good evening, everybody. Welcome back to the second half of Letters Flying Free. And Dr. Abramson just walked out the room, so we didn't have a chance to get to wish him and Ilana Mazel Tov and just their daughter's just their engagement just a week and a half ago. Very beautiful to be able to celebrate the Simcha for people who do so much to enhance our community. And we wish you and Hillel continued Mazel as and Nachas from your children. I'll leave the compliments towards the end then. Let's start at the beginning over here. So what we see about the Ralbag, as Dr. Abramson had said, is the most remarkably varied individual. I mean, think about somebody who has the patent on an instrument which is still in use today, and is somebody who is on the bookshelf of almost every base medrash. We have just have to think about the diversity of this individual. And what I'd like to do is explore a little bit of his thoughts in the next few minutes over here, just to appreciate how unusual an individual he was. So many times in our thinking, in our thought process in Judaism, the Ralbag will provide a very important anchor for us on the rationalistic side of Judaism. And this is very important. I've had many conversations with many individuals over time, and I've found that there's a lot of people who are very, so some Jews are very big philosophers, some Jews are big pragmatists, some Jews are big Kabbalists, some Jews are rationalists. And the Ralbag, along with the Rambam before him, provide a very important foundation of what Judaism is and means to a very important group of people and to, we'll call it, parts of every person's character. We're going to explore some of those together. I'd like to add one interesting thing I just came across in my readings today, actually, just last minute, about the Ralbag, to add to what Dr. Abramson had said. And that is that, interestingly enough, in one of his books on trigonometry, in fact, it was called De Sinibus Cordis et Arcubus. And I'm talking about a lot of the geometry of shapes. And he, in 1342, and he actually published it in honor of Pope Clement VI. Which is very fascinating because after Pope Innocent and that terrible era, he actually had a very close relationship with the Pope Clement. And this particular Pope, as it happened 6 years later, was an individual who went out there and tried to defend the Jews against the latest craze in history, which was the bubonic plague. So why did the bubonic plague affect the Jews, the Black Death? Because the Jews weren't as heavily affected for whatever reason. Be it Netilas Yodayim, that we washed our hands, whatever it was in history, the Jews were blamed for Black Death among everything else. And Pope Clement was in fact one of the ardent defenders of the Jews, and before that defense he had a close relationship with the Ralbag, whose brother was actually his physician, which is just a very fascinating historical wrinkle in terms of how much he contributed, just in terms of, as Dr. Abramson said, his personality and his gravitas in society. Let's start at the very beginning. There are so many different works that the Ralbag works on, and as we talked and saw in the works of Sadia Gaon, it is incredibly organized, orchestrated, point by point. In fact, when he starts writing his introduction to the Torah, he gives you the rubric and the schema for his books, his later books. He says, I'm going to write. And he tells you point by point of what he's going to write. A very, very incredibly organized individual. So here we go. Let's start at the beginning over here. So the first thing we're going to start off over here is just an interesting work aspect of psychology. Usually when you have a academic of such proportions, and certainly with the mathematical side of the brain, it doesn't often lend itself necessarily to the finesse or the soft understanding of the intricacy of emotions. However, I'd like to give you one example of just how profound an insight he has into the human psyche. He has where it starts. Now, this is actually in his introduction to his Pirush on the Torah. What we've been doing over the last few weeks is been focusing on the Ralbag's introductions, because they are the introductions of these great thinkers, because it gives us a window into what they're trying to achieve. And he says an interesting thing in the middle of a very, very long introduction. He talks about a particular facet of his writings, which in fact is very infrequent in any other writer. What he is about to describe is something we don't find elsewhere in a lot of writers. And here's what he says. I'm not going to read the whole thing, but he says, and behold, hiskamnu bebiyurenu ze levaer hato elois hamagios beparsha parsha bamidos uvadeos uvamitzvos. What he says is, I'm going to write at the end of every section, that's the way he does it, I'm going to write a toeles. A toeles literally means an outcome, a positive lesson that we can learn from sections in my Pirush. Now remember, when he's going through here, the actual section in the Torah, he's very didactically analyzing words and context and meaning. But he says, at the end of that, I'm going to write a section called Toalas, these lessons that can be learned. To the degree that I'm able to, and I'm going to support them in Talmudic literature. So I'd like to give you an example, just of one of these examples. This is why it's so beautiful. You can go through the Pirush of the Ralbag as a regular mefarish, as a regular commentator on the Bible. But then you can go to the end and have a completely different perspective on the same thing he already commented on because of these tilos. He has an example. The context of this next excerpt is in Parshas Vayishlach. So here we have the beginning of Parshas Vayishlach. This serves, of course, as a very important, metaphorically as well, in terms of in terms of the relationships of Jews and Christians as well. Because remember, Vayishlach is the parasha where you have Jacob is returning from his exile in the house of Lavan, and he's going to now encounter his brother. And a lot of the parasha spends the time preparing how they're going to interact with each other. So he says, I want to tell you something important about this interaction, and that is the Toeles HaRishon Hu Bamidos. The first one is a psychological insight, and he says the following: V'usherowi lemi sheyesh lo soneh v'yiratze shetosur sinasa mimenu sheskarev elov b'chol oiz. If you have somebody who's really, you really have a relationship of angst, there's a lot of pain, there's a lot of baggage in that relationship. He says, you know what the approach to that relationship should be? Is openness, submission. V'yagid elov kol yanov, and you tell the person what's going on, the things, your fears, your humility. Kivozeh miskarvos halavavos mashelo yeolem. Says when you stick out your hand, as painful as it is, as vulnerable as you make yourself, says that's the greatest key in to breaking a relationship of power and anger of yours. Yeah, fascinating idea. How do we see this? And he describes how we learn this directly from the interaction of Yaakov. Yaakov has now had 22 years of estrangement from his brother, and his brother feels, in his own realm, very rightfully wronged by Yaakov. And now his brother's coming back. What does Yaakov do? He extends himself. He makes himself vulnerable. He talks about his family. He sends him gifts. He opens himself up in what perhaps would be a counterintuitive move, and says, the Rabbag, we can learn from this. How many times in relationships do we have a relationship where the response is to harden, because that's perhaps the only way we can dig in our defenses? And what ultimately we're learning from this is in a healthy human being relationship that ultimately does not resolve it. What resolves it is this. This is an example where the Ralbag will look into, and beyond his grandiose and his perspective and as academia, he just says, on a humanistic level, when dealing with other people, and you can think in the backdrop of his mind, Christians and Jews, right? You can think about what he must be dealing with on a daily basis, is be vulnerable. It's a very counterintuitive point, but something which has great impact in life today. Let's move on to an interesting part of his life. The Ralbag is going to be ardently, ardently rational, which means to say that any woo-woo kind of aspects of Judaism are going to be downplayed by the Ralbag and the camp of the Rambam. So as an example, when we talk about supernatural beings, so who are supernatural beings? Examples?
Angels.
So let's say any encounter we have in angels, are there angels in the Bible? And the answer is?
Yeah.
Absolutely. The Bible talks about angels all the time. There's angels who are explicitly visiting Abraham by his tent. There are angels who are struggling with Jacob later on. There's lots of angels in the Bible. So how do you work with that? We are coming now from the camp of the Ralbag, who's heavily influenced, like the Rambam was, by Aristotelian philosophy. And the world of the spirit is something which is completely devoid of any physicality. So how do you have a spiritual being having any physical interaction with a human being who is completely or almost at least interfacing on a physical level? So here's what he says. This is his commentary on the parasha of Vayishlach later on, where Yaakov struggles with an angel. He says the following. This is in the third source. He says, V'nishar Yaakov levadoi, and Jacob remains alone. La'avir ksas kinyonov shenishar usham. So he's busy bringing over his extra belongings over from the side of the river. V'yoshen shav, v'nir lo malach benevua, ki'ilu hu hi'ish. And what happens? What happens to Yaakov? An apparition appears. Where?
In
his dream, which means to say, take a snapshot of what's going on over here. What position is Jacob in at this point in time? He is horizontal. That struggle that's going on is in the head. It's not in the nighttime. It's not with some stranger. He says, "V'le'otzim tveikuso boy v'kurvos madregosa mimenu nireh loy shu ne'evakimoy." And the battle that he has with the specter in his mind is so powerful, it is a struggle of the mind, a cerebral battleground. And then he goes on to say, we're not going to do this, and he says, so how is it that Yaakov the next morning was limping? After all, if he didn't have a real battle with him, with his angel, then so what's going on over here? How did he develop So he goes on in a very logical framework. He says two suggestions. He talks about, you know, that when people are, let's say, having a terrifying nightmare and they feel like they're falling, he says you can measure that their muscles tense up as they are in that REM cycle, as they're falling, because it has physical symptoms to the psychological experience that they're going through. And he talks about other aspects and relationships of men and wife where psychology can affect physics, which is fascinating, because what he's saying is over here is that Yaakov woke up with a psychosomatic injury from a psychological experience. When we're in school, we're always drawing pictures. We're going to leave the questions to the end, if that's right, Yehuda. When we go through school, well, what do we have? We always have the pictures, and there's this angel, and there's dust, and there's a struggle, and there's wrestling from the Torah. Where do we know it? From Yaakov. But according to the Ralbag over here, the picture of Yaakov was you're sleeping in his bed like any other night, probably on the ground in a sleeping bag at this point in time. He's on a journey, but it's not as we imagined it. The Ralbag over here is avoiding the interaction of a physical being and a spiritual being, and has reframed the entire situation as the Rambam would do in this particular situation. Can you hold it for a second? So hang on to the question. I'd love to hear. I just want to just get a little ground. As another example, so not when we're dealing with, let's say, supernatural beings. What about supernatural events? So meaning to say, so how do you view that? Now the Ralbag over here, having written books on trigonometry, on algebra, he is creating instruments to measure elliptical orbits. He is a man of the cold and hard. He is a man who understands logic, who deals with the here and now and what you can measure, what you can understand, and what you can and what can be calibrated. So how do you understand a world of miracles? So he has a very unique approach, which often serves as the foil to most of the later Mepharshim, including the Malbim, Rav Leibush, to the Abarbanel. Many other people use the Ralbag as their foil, and he says that he has a very interesting approach. Here is the example we're going to take. This is his writing in Sefer Yehoshua, in the book of Joshua. Why would you expect it to find in the book of Joshua? What miracle of note occurs? Okay, so there's a few things we can note. There's a few miracles. One of the first major miracle that occurs is that the Jordan River dries up. There's an occurrence where the Jordan River dries up, and it stands as a pillar, and the whole of Israel crosses the Jordan River. And this is where the Ralbag jumps in, and by the way, he jumps in by Exodus as well, because it's the parallel thing. And he says a very fascinating and salient point. He says the following. He says, Shekfar, Hishrishuz, on the top line, our sages invested into us the understanding, Ki lo yischadesh b'mofsim davar chadash, that there's no new item in any equation which God sort of pulls out of the bag a rabbit out of nowhere. And he says that's why in the Gemara, one of the sages, Rava, one of the central sages of the Talmudic time, was concerned how was it that God created this open earth where Korach falls down, as it's described in Korach. How could this be that there's a new aspect of creation? The Gemara has to deal with that. And then he goes through a number of examples. In the midst of his examples of miracles, and we're going to deal with them in just a second outside, he says a very interesting point, and this is really essentially his argument, by the underline. He says, "V'chein lo yitzu'ar ba'asiyos davar ma, sh'yemetziyuso soser atzmon." God will never create a self-contradicting idea or concept in this world. What does that mean? Ki ilu tomar asiyas meruba hakoter shovel etzaloi. So he says, for instance, God will never create a square where the diagonal is equal to one of the sides. Right? I mean to say that's a self-contradictory fact. God has set certain rules in motion, and although God did not call it Pythagoras when he created it, that means to say that will exist irrespective of what will happen later on in reality. He says, let's say you have a triangle with more than 180 as a sum total of all of their angles. Or making cold fire. I mean to say there's certain rules that God has in the world, and God's never going to change those things. And therefore, our perspective on miracles is we have to re-understand how a miracle is happening. So for instance, so he says, what about Korach? So it sounds like the Chumash describes the ground opens up and closes over Korach. So what's going on over here? So he says, well, we know that we've done research, and we've seen that there's certain parts in the land where there's an instability, and we already see that from that area of the land there's smoke rising, which is an indication that we're on the Rift Valley. And lo and behold, the Sinai Peninsula is on the Jordan Rift Valley, which goes all the way to down the right side of Africa, down to where I grew up in South Africa. We actually see the end of the Rift Valley, just close to Pretoria, which goes all the way up the side of Africa. It's one of the tectonic plate shifts, which goes through Mitzpe Ramon, all the way up through Israel. It is a tectonic plate. So he says there was such an area. What was the miracle? The miracle wasn't that God made something supernatural occur. It was that God allowed the natural to occur at the right time. Meaning God wasn't pulling anything out of the hat. God was simply allowing what should happen to work. And another example, he says, how is it that we know that in Tanakh, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah were these three individuals who are given the option of submission to the Babylonian overlord, or to jump into the fire? And they jumped into the fire, and explicitly the psukim say that the verses said they were not harmed. So what was going on over there? How did they miraculously survive? So he says, well, maybe the fire had cooled down to a point that it wasn't dangerous anymore. Maybe that they anointed themselves with some sort of oil which prevented them being burned. I mean, this is the degree that the Ralbag was saying this. Now, certain people don't read the books of the Ralbag because of this. This is an example of where people feel that this is too much. A poetic license the Ralbag has in reading Tanakh. Let's say Exodus. That was a pretty big lights and show. How did that occur? So he says the following. He says, here we are, as an example. He says, "V'nomar," in this last paragraph, "Shekfar yidme shenemar," it would appear to me, "Sheina nachas amayim bilti nagarim davar chadash." He says, look, water not flowing is not something new to us. He says, "Ki kvar yikre baze l'mayim kishiyeh lahem davar moneya me'atnua." He says, look, anything, if water is not flowing down, it must mean there's something pushing it up. Right, so for instance, he doesn't use this example, but when you're driving on the highway, the raindrops go up your windshield. Why? Because the inertia and therefore the wind speed is pushing them up the windshield, even though they're not flowing downwards. So there must be something else there. Maybe God created, but my face, but avira samoch l'mayimahem, geshem safiri av monei hamayim mahirida. He said there must have been some sort of heavily pressurized mist that was pushing the water upwards at the right time, right? Which is, all there might have been a wind at just the right angle, at just the right speed, which was pushing the water in such a way that the water rose on either in the Exodus of Kriyas Yamsuf or by the Jordan River later on. By the way, the Jordan River is a little easier. Jordan River is a little easier to understand because the Jordan River only had to have one side taken care of. Meaning when you stop the river, the other side disappears. So the Jordan River, in fact, interestingly enough, I read a paper that they've documented the times when the Jordan River has stopped running throughout history, and a number of times in the last century, in fact, where there was particular incidents, whether it be trees falling down or winds blowing in such a way that the Jordan River dried up. And you think to yourself, oh my goodness, how could we even think about that? That's just such a that is such a heretical way of looking at the Bible. And the answer is, as Gersonides, the Ralbag himself believes that that's the way Hashem interacts with the world. Was there a miracle? What was the miracle? It wasn't that Hashem was breaking reality, it was that he was using reality at the right time. It's true that it could have happened. It's true that there was water pressure and air pressure and wind, but the beauty of the miracle was that Hashem facilitated all of that at the right moment for the right amount of time and closed again at the end. That's what the Ralbag says. Very different way of looking at it, and this is just so important to appreciate. Sometimes we like to have a Judaism, we like to have a philosophy system which fits just the way we think. And it's important to remember that there's a very broad spectrum of thinkers in Judaism, and to some people this resonates a great deal, and to some people it does not resonate a great deal. But remember that it's part of the spectrum, and to some people this is the way they understand the world, and this is what the Gersonides understood the world to be. And this is very important to understand. This is part of mainstream Jewish thought over here. This is an example of, again, he's addressing the supernatural, not in the form of beings, but in the form of actual miracles. Another example later on, we're not going to go to the actual text itself, but as somebody mentioned before, and the sun standing still. The sun stood still in Joshua. Now, as far as you go, and as academic as you want to be, there ain't no way the sun is standing still, right? Everything is moving. Everything's moving around everything. Gravity is always in operation. Nothing just stops. Do you know how fast the earth is moving? You know what I'm saying? Like, meaning to say that it doesn't just stop. So the Ralbag said, and he says, if it had stopped, it would have meant that Joshua was in fact a greater miracle bringer than Moses, right? Because nobody's ever stopped the sun before explicitly in all of the Bible. So what happens? So this, the Rabbi says, no. What it means to say is, again, it's about perspective. They were chasing the enemies. The enemies were running towards the hills and the caves. What Hashem allowed them to do was Hashem allowed them to chase the enemies with such speed, with such alacrity, it almost felt like, you know, those moments in life where time stood still and you're able to do so much in one day. He said it was, the sun stood still subjectively for their actions, where time was no longer a factor as they achieved what God allowed them to achieve. Meaning to say, we're not talking about a physical reality, we're talking about a psychological reality in terms of understanding it over here. Once again, don't necessarily take it at the face value of what the texts were. On the same note, I just found a very interesting thing. This is a translation actually from Rabbi Natan Slufkin. It doesn't come out so well over here. In his book Milchamos Hashem, the book of Milchamos Hashem is one of his great works, which Dr. Abramson mentioned just beforehand, where it's meant to be. And if you read the most exquisite description of how much he wants to bring God's light into this world by this book, essentially it's about his philosophy system and his system of God's providence and how Hashem interacts with this world. We're going to see a little bit more of this at the very end. But in amongst this, he has very interesting things where he talks about the hierarchy of life forms, which is very fascinating, because Rabbi Slifkin over here is addressing evolution, and is there space for evolutionary thinking within Jewish sources. And the Rabbag himself says absolutely. The Rabbag talks about tiers of life forms, talking about how humanity is the greatest form or developed life form, which is already talking in the terms of the evolutionary chain that we have over here, well, a number of centuries well before Darwin came along to describe that there was these movement or progression from one to the other. The way the Rabbag looked at creation was a tiered progression as well, which is the most fascinating insight as well, just in terms of the newness of his thinking. Let's move on to another really interesting point over here, and that is over here in terms of Parshanut. The Rabbag is a very interesting person in the following regard. The Rabbag is what sometimes you may call is a very normal Parshan. Very normal, very chilled out Parshan. What I mean by that, here's an example. So what we just did recently actually in the Sefer Shmuel is that the name Shmuel comes from the words from the root what? Well, where's Shmuel's name come from? The prophet Samuel. What is the root three letters? It is not Shema that God heard. It is rather that May Hashem from God She'iltiv. I borrowed or requested him from God. So then the Rabbag says, but if that's true, then what should his name be? Shaul. His name should be Shaul, requested. That's the most direct expression of the root of the word Sha'al. So V'im Omar Omer, if somebody would question and say, Shaya Ra'ui im kein shetikre shmo Shaul, Omar nu loy, ki lo yadakta ku korea Hashem es kol kach. He says, not everybody was being so medactic. That's what they meant. Right, it was figurative language. They meant it. It sounded good. Right, they know what it came from, the word Sha'al, but his name wasn't Sha'al, it was Shmuel. It was beautiful. What the Ralbag is essentially saying is don't make a castle, don't make an enterprise on such a small deal. Some things you can just let slide. I mean to say the Ralbag is very much a linguist, but at the same time there's certain things. Meaning just don't necessarily build the whole structure on this type of insight. Right? Just as an example there, he as opposed to perhaps the Ibn Ezra, would be somebody who would be willing to let certain things slide, which is actually a very unique perspective. Ethics and war. Two more very fascinating points over here as we get towards the end of this. And that is ethics and war. Happens to be that one of the very difficult, for any, we'll call it modern reader of the Bible, has a lot of trouble when it comes to reading the descriptions of Israel going to war in the land of Canaan. In the land of Canaan, they come in and they're told to obliterate man, woman, child of these seven nations, without exception seemingly, which is really, really, it's hard for the, you know, we'll call it the Western ear to hear. The Rabbag says something which is really a very fascinating insight into this, that when reading through the verses, we're not going to do them now, but these are the verses in Sefer Devarim, in Perek Chaf, in the 20th Perek, where it talks about the description of going to war. And it seems that the Psukim actually have two divisions. There's regular nations. If you go to fight against a regular nation, let's say for land, then you offer them peace. When you fight against the seven nations of the land of Canaan, then it's obliteration. The Rabbag goes out on a limb, and like the Barbanel later on after him, says the most fascinating, interesting insight, and he says that no. The Torah means that every war that is fought has to have a peace offer at the beginning. Meaning to say, there is never a carte blanche for Jews to walk into the land of Israel and to totally decimate another nation. No nation ever was destroyed without the offer of peace and subjugation beforehand, which is a very fascinating, which is a revolutionary perspective, moving away from the perspectives of, let's say, predecessors like Rashi, Ramban, who say that there's a division of labor over here. The Ralbag, and later followed by later Mefarshim, give us more of a humanistic perspective to war. And you can imagine, as Dr. Abramson said, he's not living in a very harmonious Europe. But at the same time, he is very much a forward thinker, and that perspective informs the way he understands, the mitzvahs of Yeshiva Aretz, the way the land was settled. Last and very, very fascinating point, and that is about suffering and providence. I'm talking about the book of Job, of Eov. This is a translation of his introduction to the book of Job. The Ralbag says something which is quite remarkable. And I found that there's many different systems of dealing with suffering and injustice in this world. And what he suggests over here is something which helps some people and makes it worse for others. Okay, so just what he says is the following. In brief summation, he says, look, that there are bad things which happen because people bring them upon themselves. Meaning to say, let's talk about, on a more pragmatic level, a person who's got a life where they eat lots of sugar, they consume a lot of sugar, don't do a lot of exercise, have a lot of fatty foods, and there's going to be symptoms or consequences for that type of lifestyle. So the person can say, God, why am I suffering? And the answer is, well, because of the lifestyle you led. So that's a simple model of it. And he says, spiritually as well, there's types of lifestyles which work like that. He says, but then there's things which happen which are beyond that, which clearly cannot be the workings or the doings of the individual themselves. So he says the most fascinating insight, and this is where he says it. He says that there are types of things which is what he calls mikre, which means to say there's a system in place in the world, and that system, in fact, operates without specific relationship to individuals. Meaning to say, there's a cause and effect. The nature which God put into place is going to work in a cause and effect nature, in a cause and effect way. And sometimes we, as the populace, may be governed as a nation by Hashem's providence, but as individuals, we don't have that providence necessarily all the time ourselves. Now, it goes into how a person can eject themselves up into it. But on the default, a person doesn't necessarily have individual hashgacha, which is what he suggests in the introduction to the book of Job. Which means to say, his suggestion over here, which is a profound suggestion, is that some suffering, some misfortune, didn't have a target. This is what he's suggesting in the book of Job. This to some people is something which is most, in a certain sense, liberating. Which means to say that sometimes when things happen, it wasn't because I was bad. It wasn't because that was targeted and destined for me. It wasn't because that something I did was terribly wrong. It's the way it was. For some people that's devastating, because that means to say that there are moments in time where I'm outside the sphere of that protection. Okay? Not that you can't get back into it, but there's sometimes where I'm ejected from that bubble of hashkacha, of divine providence, which is the most terrifying description. Just to read his own words over here, at the end, he says, in this way, it's possible to maintain the sublunar forms of existence whose survival depends upon the uniform elements found in the substances that compose them. The cause for the unity in the sublunar nature is the impact upon the substances from heavenly bodies. Meaning to say there's a system in motion over here. From this standpoint, then we can deduce that such calamities strike us as pure chance. Wow. That's a very, very powerful point over here. Meaning this is, to me, is a fascinating point in the sense that this is the convergence of both philosophy, mathematics, and psychology all at once. Where his perspective on the human nature of suffering, at the same time as the academic, the world called the scientific side of how the world operates, and as well at the same time the philosophy of the rationalistic Ralbag, all converging into one point over here when he forms this. I think this is most fascinating for the following reason, is that if we think about this, what we covered over here, well, we covered a few very interesting and salient points. We talked about the psychology of the Ralbag. We talked about how his insight into making amends with other people, as an example. We talked about interacting with supernatural events, angels, miracles, and how he sometimes waters down those events from it being in the same grandiose as we may have naturally read it. We talked a little bit about war and ethics and diktuk, the Ralbag's willingness to be able to also read the Tanakh more laissez-faire, at the same time as also his perspective and his forward thinking in terms of ethics and morals. And finally, we concluded with a much more heavier note, which is the notion of there being a system of Hashem's interaction with this world, which is the flip side of the coin of miracles, which is that there is a system which is always moving. And sometimes that system doesn't specifically notice the individuals. Once again, very, very salient points of a great thinker who still adorns our shelves today. What I'd like to say is just to start at the end, is just to say a very big thank you. Thank you so much to our very own and one and only Dean Abramson, who put together what was really a remarkable series. I personally have grown tremendously just from the experience of having learned and prepared for this, and I hope that you, everybody in this room, and everybody in the global classroom that are watching and continue to watch this astounding series of six have learned from this and will continue to gain. And we thank Hillel and Ilana for their incredible investment in this community. I want to also thank our film crew on staff, Boaz Abramson as well, who doesn't just do filming but does questioning as well, which we'll address in just a moment. And this has really been a very exciting moment. Anybody has questions about furthering this opportunity, please speak to us afterwards. At this moment in time, let's take questions, if that's all right. Yeah. Dr. Abramson, you want to?
I have two questions.
Yes.
These incredible people, these kinds of geniuses, I can only imagine that they must have had a patron or somebody, taking care of the minutiae of their lives. And secondly, who are their incredible wives? Because behind every great man, and of course it's Women's Day. So
absolutely. Now, International Women's Day. Shout out to International Women's Day. You're right. I think that's more directed to Dr. Abramson, actually, the historical side of things. Right. I know that he did actually get a lot of patronage for his inventions and his writings, because he was so well sought after. I think one of the kings commissioned him to write. I don't remember which book it was, but I don't know fully. Right, Dr. Abramson, can you speak to that?
No, I don't think I have anything to add.
Fascinating.
I don't think he's allowed
it yet. You heard it, yes.
Just a couple quick questions.
Yes.
One, when going back to Yaakov and the struggle with the Malach, I've heard people say, or I've heard people say that the whole idea of him wrestling with angels is just psychological.
Yes, well that's what Rabbi is saying.
The fact that he was sleeping, that he could be hallucinating potentially.
Okay, potentially as well, but the point is he wasn't in a lucid state.
Yeah,
that's exactly what the Rabbi is saying.
Also, when it comes to the miracles, the Rabbi was suggesting mist or other stuff. I thought it could just be geysers. It could be a double geyser.
Possibly. I just say there ain't geysers in the Sinai Peninsula.
Well, there could have been one.
That's the only hitch on the thing. Boaz?
Yeah, so you said that... Wait. Correct me if I'm wrong. If I recall from my third grade Parsha class, what happened was they crossed the river and then they left something behind, so Yaakov went back to get
Correct.
It, and that's where he fought the angel. So he goes across the river, then he comes back, and then he decides to take a nap.
That's what it seems to be. Yeah, it's interesting. He actually glides over that point when he describes it.
Why would he go to sleep randomly?
Exhaustion.
Yeah, and wouldn't you want?
It could be. It is very possible that the Tanakh doesn't go to the level or the stakes to the pain to tell us every stage of his going to bed schedule. So it could be that it took it for granted that we knew that this was now in a sleeping state. It could have also been another possibility is addressing the point more full on. Is a lot of times when God interacts with human beings, the way the Rambam describes it, and we're very much in the Rambam camp over here, is it's almost like a experience, it's almost like a fit, an epileptic fit, where the senses are almost destroyed from the experience of the magnitude of the divine. So it could have been that he didn't fall asleep, but that as the way he describes this prophecy set on, and when it set on, he collapsed. So that's why we're not being described as, yeah.
Yeah, There must be multiple theories that say that the Nevi'im were epileptic or something. Because, like, the whole, like, epileptic kind of thing seems like it could somehow have some...
Yeah, well, but remember, we're looking anachronistically. I mean, we're saying all we have today is epilepsy to be able to look at. When it happened in those days, we're talking about not so much as a medical condition, but rather a description of a human being, of a physical being that cannot. What was that?
Yeah, they used to call it the falling sick.
True, but I'm just saying, like, they're different subsets. Meaning to say that prophecy experience in those days was a bigger subset than what we call epilepsy today. Epilepsy today maybe our only perspective into what it means to be for human being to be in such a state. The Rambam describes it as being that is the typical nature of experience of the divine, simply because it's like the car when you're going too fast in a car and the car starts shuddering. The car can't take the motion that it's in. It's too much. The body can't take. That's what's going on over there.
Okay. It said that he fought with him the whole night, right?
Mm-hmm.
So usually you sleep a whole night, so I don't know, like, probably he fell asleep or he fainted or something.
Possibly, you know, it's very definitely true. Could be the whole night as well. Could it be the fight, as the other Mepharshim said? But one thing which interests me is coming back to Yehuda's point, is that if it's a psychological struggle, I mean, it's not just a bad dream. It means to say that in his dream, he is struggling against something. That struggle was so hard, it took him until the morning to break out.
I've heard people...
That's what seems to be going on over here. That's how hard this experience was.
Even people nowadays, when they wake up from, like, intense dreams, they're sweating, they're out of breath.
And yes.
Correct. So that goes to... that. Imagine. For sure. And that goes to his psychosomatic experience that he describes in the Torah at the end of the section. Exactly like you said, where he says, how could there be physical symptoms of a psychological experience? Anyways, that is... Maybe we'll take questions afterwards. Thank you, everybody. I don't want to keep everybody. Thank you so much for coming. Looking forward to seeing us at the next opportunity.
Thank you.